Hi students, welcome to this video in which we are going to discuss how we should prepare geography for UPSC. Before we start, let me tell you that in this video, I am fixing the idea or the coverage of the video only to the geography for general studies. We are only going to talk about geography as a part of GS. If you are a geography optional student, then this video is not for you. Right, because geography for optional requires a lot more coverage that we are not going to cover for this video. In fact, if you have geography optional, then you don't really need to prepare geography for GS because that will just be a subset of your optional subject. So this video is exclusively for those students who do not have geography as an optional subject, but for their general studies, they have to prepare geography because it carries a lot of weightage in the UPSC exam. Now, geography is a challenging subject without a doubt. Even I feel that it is one of the most tricky parts of the preparation because it is not one of those sections which you don't like, so you can leave them and get away with them, right? I mean, there are some sections, you know, for example, when I used to prepare, I used to hate ancient history. So I used to leave ancient history and I was still doing okay because the coverage or the weightage of that section was very less. Of course, I used to prepare art and culture and all that. But with geography, you cannot manage to do that because the coverage is actually very big. I mean, the weightage in the exam is too much and that needs to be prepared. Unfortunately, in geography, there are a number of textbooks in market available which are specifically written for UPSC exam. But my first advice to you will be, do not buy any of those textbooks. My first advice to all of you, if you are preparing geography only for general studies, do not buy the, I will not take the names, but the very famous books by very famous scholars which are available in market, titled as Geography for General Studies, do not buy those books because those authors did not really pay attention that whether they were writing for GS or they were writing for optional. They generally, those people were geographers and they got a little lazy or I would say a little ambitious and they basically, just shortened their optional books only and made a GS book, which is not the right approach, which is not the right method to prepare for geography. Those books are humongous. They are very big. They cover a lot of things. They are good. I'm not saying they are not good. But the problem is that if you are on a calendar, if you are going to prepare in a time limit, these books are going to consume a lot of your time. And you will not have that much of time, in your UPSC preparation because geography is not the only thing you are going to prepare. Right. So you have to be very conscious that you are not buying any of those books. The books that you are probably going to refer to are firstly NCERTs. There is absolutely no replacement for NCERTs. You have to cover the NCERTs starting from standard 6 to 12th. Even if you don't cover standard 6 to 8, that is okay because they get repeated. But starting from standard 9th to 12th, every single NCERT you will have to cover in great detail. Right, that is something you will have to do and there is no exception. In my opinion, the NCERT books are actually maximum and most useful for geography only. Geography is the subject where NCERT books actually add a lot of value. They pack a lot of punches. They actually cover the syllabus really nicely. And year after year, there have been direct questions from geography's NCERTs as well in the UPSC prelims as well as mains. So NCERTs are something which you just cannot avoid for a solid preparation of geography. There have been incidents where the questions have been even from the examples of the geography textbooks. So you cannot skip the geography textbooks if you are actually working on your NCERTs. So I have given you 4 or 5 NCERTs to prepare from. Apart from that, you should buy one book, that one book I recommend, that is Go Xing Liang. I'm sure all of you must have heard the name. It's by a foreign author. It's called Certificate Physical and Human Geography. Certificate. It's a very, very good book. Physical and Human Geography. It's a school textbook. not from India, of course, and it has been written by a person, Gauche Leong. I always get confused in the spelling, but that does not matter. This is the spelling, Gauche Leong. So this gentleman has written a very, very beautiful book on, and it's a thin book. It's a thin book. It gives graphs, it gives diagrams, and he explains the physical geography and the human geography quite vividly. Right. So, for your physical geography, this book is going to give you a really solid coverage. I mean, if you are preparing for GS, this is a really, really rock solid book. In fact, even for to the optional students, I always recommend this book because this is a really solid, really good book. Right. The third resource that you will require is always you have to have an atlas. A very proper standard atlas. Either by Oxford's Atlas or by Orient Longman. One of these atlases you should have, and you should have it with you all the time. Right? So it should not that, okay, today I am going to study Atlas. No, Atlas is not supposed to be studied like that. Atlas has to be a reference book. You must get an atlas right away. Keep it with you all the time. Right, you should keep an atlas with you all the time, wherever you study, whatever your study table or your study bed or whatever is there, one atlas should be kept just in the vicinity of that place all the time, because you will need an atlas regularly. Why? I will tell you. And one thing which I want you all to invest in is a dictionary of geography. Is a dictionary of geography. Oxford Publications normally publishes a number of dictionaries of subjects. I will advise that you buy a dictionary of geography and keep it as a reference book whenever you read a term, the meaning of it, which you cannot really, you don't really understand totally. Right? Then always refer to that in the dictionary. Dictionary will give you subtle points. And you know, the idea of these reference books is that they increase your knowledge, or they create a knowledge base in a subtle and a regular way. You know, for example, you are reading a newspaper and the news comes that a bus fell in a gorge and these many people died. Now, you don't know what exactly a gorge is. You have an idea that probably it's a, you know, it's some kind of a pit or something, but you don't know what a gorge is. Then the best idea is open your dictionary, see the meaning of gorge. They will differentiate the gorge with very too many similar terms. They will give you solid examples of gorge as well, and that thing is automatically added to your knowledge base. So your knowledge base will keep increasing all the time in geography if you have these two materials which are there. If you are following UPSC Pathshala's course, then of course there is no need to buy Gauche Leong, because we cover that. Atlas, I still recommend. Dictionary, I still recommend. There is no need to go through NCERTs as well, because NCERTs also we cover through our video lectures. And the questions and the quiz, NCERT based question bank. Now, this is about the material. Except this, do not buy anything. I am very clear on that. Except all of this, even if you are a non-UPSC Pathshala student, except for this material, do not purchase even a single book on geography. That is a very, very important aspect. That is something you need to learn. And because you have to optimize your resources. You cannot buy 1,000 books and keep studying them all the time, because you have other things to study as well. Now, of course, one more resource which is there is the newspaper, because even in geography, you will see that half your question paper will be based on newspapers only, right? There will be questions, and you know, they will ask about some geographical features or some geographical details, but those things would have been in news. That is a very important aspect, right? So, for example, in 2018, there was a news item that was very widely covered, that how the Aral Sea had shrunk because of the human activities, right? There was a clear shrinkage of Aral Sea because of human activities. And in 2018 prelims, they asked a question based on that right away, that out of these three, Aral Sea, Black Sea and Baikal Lake, which water body is actually shrinking due to man-made activities or human activities. Now you will see how this question is asked. It was not there in the textbooks. It was there in all the newspapers. It was there in all the newspapers, Down to Earth magazine, everywhere it was there. So the answer was Aral Sea. So, all these things are there all the time. They even ask map-based questions. Though on map-based questions I'll come. Let's start with map only. So starting with the map, it is generally considered to be very tricky because sometimes the questions on the map are very, very tricky. And I know that. I mean, I know this for a fact. For example, I think in 2018 or I think 17, I'm not really sure, they asked a question on which of the cities are closest in terms of longitude to Delhi, right? And the four cities were, let me plot a map and you will probably get a better visual that why this question was so tricky. If this is India and let's say this is Delhi, then they gave four cities of central India only, right? The interesting thing was they gave four cities. I mean, if they would have given, let's say, Lucknow or something, then you would have understood that these cities are far away. But no, if this is Delhi, they gave the other cities as Hyderabad, as Bangalore, and as Nagpur. That, and this is the longitude that which is passing from Delhi. So you have to tell that which, again, this might be a misleading map, I just hand drew it, that which of the cities is closest to Delhi in terms of longitude. Now, I'm leaving this to you for you as a homework. There is no way to prepare for these questions, right? I mean, I'm sorry to tell you, there is very, very difficult, it's very, very difficult to be able to prepare for these questions because, these questions are probably based on some basic knowledge. The idea is that probably for some 5-6 big cities of India, right, probably some 5-6 big cities, you need to know everything, that what longitude they are on, and so all these things you need to know about 5-6-7 big cities of India. But I will not blame you if you were not able to solve this question, because it is kind of an impossible question that if you have a perfectly good idea of the map, then you will be able to do it. Now for map, I always give this one tip to all my students. That one tip is that you cannot learn the map in a day, in a week, in a month. You cannot do that. Map learning is an years long exercise, right? So even if you are right now in college and you are planning to give the UPSC exam 4 years, 5 years down the line, in that case, this is one preparation you should start right now from today. Buy an atlas, and whatever newspaper you are reading or whatever geographical feature you are listening to, let's say you read a news about Nagpur, that RSS's headquarters is in Nagpur. Just open the atlas, see where Nagpur is. And when you are looking at the atlas, do not be Arjun. Right, you know what Arjun is? Who Arjun is? There is a mythological story that when Arjun went to a aiming competition, I think to get married in a Swayamvar or somewhere, then he only saw the eye of the fish. Right, you all must have heard the story. There is an idiom in Hindi, that's machli ki aankh dekhna. That means he only saw the thing which he was supposed to aim at. So don't be Arjun while you are studying atlas. So if you are locating Nagpur, do not just look at Nagpur. Just look around as well. That, okay, this is Nagpur, where Nagpur is. Oh, which hills are there nearby? Or which rivers are there nearby? Or probably, what are the longitudinal matters of this area? Oh, is it a hilly area or a plain area? Or probably, probably a desert or whatever is that. So, when you are looking at the atlas, try to gather a little more information as well about the area, about the region, and close the atlas and finish it off. So the point is that even if you are doing 5 such entries a day, then probably in your 400 days of preparation, you will be doing more than 2000 entries. And trust me, if you are doing these 2000 entries, there is no way that out of the 10 questions that might come based on map, you might not be able to solve 9 of them. There is no way that will happen. at least 9 of them you will be able to solve very easily. Right, you know, for example, we all know how Syria, Israel, they have been in news. Syria, Israel, Jordan, this whole area has been in news. We all have read in newspapers the big stories about Syria war and everything that has been going on for a very long time. But again, they asked what? They asked the question on the map that which of these countries, Syria, Israel, Jordan, and I think the question was, other option given was Lebanon. Which of these countries do not open to Mediterranean Sea? Now, if you were just reading the newspaper and closing it, putting away, it's fine. Then you will find this question to be impossible. But when I saw this question, I found it to be very easy. Because the moment I used to read about Syria, I used to see my atlas. The moment I used to see about Israel, Jordan, Lebanon, somehow all these countries have been in news. And they are all neighboring countries. Then I was able to tell that out of these four, Syria has a big coast, of course. Israel has a big coast. Lebanon has a coast. Jordan is a landlocked country. So naturally, it does not have anything to do with the Mediterranean Sea. So the point is that the atlas has to be prepared in a regular manner, in a day-to-day manner, and all the atlas-based questions, not all, but majority of the atlas-based questions are going to be based on very, very clearly current affairs. If you are not finishing off your current affairs along with your atlas, your chances of being able to solve the atlas based questions or the map based questions is extremely low. So that is a practice thing, right? When you read newspaper, when you study newspaper or whatever, if you are our student, whenever you listen to our videos of current affairs, it is very important that you sit down with an atlas. Whenever a geographical feature appears, be it a city, be it a country, be it a hill, be it a river, be it anything, always open the atlas, locate it, just see the river nearby, close the atlas, get done with that. You will see that out of 10 questions that can possibly be asked on the map, 9 of them you will be able to answer for sure. Having talked about the idea of maps, now let's come to the basic core content of the subject geography that you need to prepare for general studies. There are 3 sections, I would believe, that which are there in this preparation. You can actually understand it through 3 parts. First part is the concepts. The concepts of geography. For that, you may refer to our lectures on physical geography and human geography, or you may refer to Leong and NCERT. Now, these concepts you need to understand first of all, right? So, these concepts might include something, for example, what concepts are important? Because on concepts, there are 1,000 books which are there in the market, but again, you don't need to read them. What are the concepts which are important? First is probably the solar system. Then, the formation of Earth. In this also, specifically, I could say plate tectonics. And continental drift, right? After that, the ideas of climate, weather, and this part you need to understand very, very properly, the factors that affect climate. This is probably the most important part of your syllabus, that which are the factors which influence the climate. Now, when you are studying this part, do not just go through them or mug them up, right? You have to understand, you have to realize, and you have to learn it with a number of examples. For that, I always recommend Leong or our lectures, of course. But the point is that you always need to be ready with lectures, or you always need to be ready with a number of examples which are there for that. Right. So that is a very, very important aspect. Here, you need to learn this along with the map. That is going to, work a lot. I mean, you need to, when you are studying this factor, you need to understand that why in various parts of the world or various parts of India, the weather or climate is of the nature the way it is. That is a very important learning curve you need to have. Related to that is the climatic zones of the world, that you need to learn very, very importantly, and then probably the natural disasters. These are some most important concepts that you need to learn for physical geography. Once you learn these concepts, then you need to understand their applicability in world as well as in India. Naturally, when you are studying about India, the knowledge has to be more deep. You have to learn, in India, you have to have more depth in your knowledge. You need to know about states. You need to know about mountains. You need to know about rivers. And along with rivers, their tributaries. Very favorite question of UPSC. Right. Again, as I had told you, that all this does not come to you naturally. All this will not come to you in a day. You will have to be a daily practitioner of this to be able to learn that. Right. So all these things you will. So we have covered states, mountains, rivers, tributaries. What else is left? Desert. Deserts of the country, mountain ranges, right? I mean, that is a very important aspect. Mountain ranges. So all these things, the features of them, the vegetation, the agriculture, the minerals. So all these aspects you need to learn about India. In India, about India, you need to have a lot more knowledge than you need to have about the world. Coming to the world, you need to know about the oceans. You need to know about continents. Right? You need to know about the coastal lines. That's a very, very important aspect. Almost every alternate year, I see a question that is about which countries are coastal, or, if you just learn the coast of every continent, then half your map is actually understood somehow. So even for a country like Africa, you need to learn, which countries are the coastal countries. You can make, some kind of a small formula for yourself or something. That is something you need to do even for India as well, right? So in India, when you start studying the map, the first thing you should learn is, you should start only along with the coast, that, let's say, starting from Gujarat, which are the countries which are in coast? Gujarat, then followed by Maharashtra, then followed by Goa, then followed by probably Karnataka, then Kerala, then Tamil Nadu, then Andhra Pradesh, then Odisha, then West Bengal. So this coastal line of India, you need to understand. Similarly, when you are working on a continent, let's say you are talking of Africa. In this case also, you need to learn. This horn is somewhere here. Horn is Somalia. It is somewhere here. So anyway, so you need to learn that which are the coastal zones of the country. That's a very, very important aspect of it. You need to learn the climate. You need to learn about the minerals and the vegetation. You also need to learn very importantly about the tribes. Now these are some easy, very, very easy factors, low hanging fruits like tribes, national parks in India, national parks or biosphere reserves in India. Every single year at least one or two questions come from it, and then always print a list and try to mug it up, just before the prelims. That is going to help you. So the point is that if you are following this approach to prepare for geography in a nutshell, it should be enough in the prelims also to get through and, somewhere around 80 to 90% questions right in geography. That should be your aim, because hitting the total 100% might be, I would say, very difficult in geography, but getting an 80% or getting an 85% is an achievable target in geography that you should always aspire. Remember, geography also has a lot in common than with environment. So if we club geography and environment, then every single year at least 25 questions are being asked from this zone. So there is no way you can take geography lightly. And take my advice, if you follow these approaches while preparing, it is going to help you. It is going to make you some kind of a very, very expertly prepared candidate in the subject.